In the interest of time, I'm not going to go into detail on the congressman's bio, not least because I want him to do a little bit of that. But suffice to say, Representative James Langevin been representing the 2nd District of Rhode Island since 2000. He is currently the ranking member of the House Armed Services Committee and, highly relevant to this, the co-chair and indeed the co-founder of the Congressional Cybersecurity Caucus. I should say, for the benefit of people who are hoping to see Senator McCain, unfortunately, Senator McCain's schedule changed, but it is truly a case that the senator's loss is our gain. It gives extra time with Congressman Langevin, who not only is one of the relatively few, perhaps there are increasingly more people in Congress who are taking an interest in cybersecurity, but very few have the understanding and knowledge of Representative Langevin. So I'd like to begin the conversation sort of in line with New America's sort of interest in understanding how people get into this field, and we heard a little bit of that on the last panel, of you giving us a sense of how you sort of got to where you are, and what was it about cybersecurity that made you think, you know, this is the thing that I, one of the things that I want to focus on?
Sure. Well, I kind of came into this field by happenstance, if you will. I was the chairman at the time of the Emerging Threats Subcommittee on the Homeland Security Committee, and I thought most of the time we'd be looking at the chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear threats to the country, and focusing on the really WMD issues. And I can still remember this day when my staff director came in to me and said, "Boss, you really need to get this this Aurora brief from Idaho National Labs and the vulnerability they disclosed and discovered in SCADA systems that could lead to catastrophic failures in critical infrastructure." So I didn't know what a SCADA system was at the time. That has since changed dramatically, and it was a real eye opener. Since then, at that time, after the brief, we started doing a deep dive on our vulnerabilities in cyber. And it became readily apparent that we have great vulnerabilities. We're obviously very dependent on the internet, but we also have good exposure in such a vast, if you will, attack space, and that it's an ongoing challenge. And so subsequent to that, I was asked to co-chair the CSIS Commission on Cybersecurity for the 44th Presidency. And then Mike McCall and I also created the Cybersecurity Caucus, and still we're co-founders and current still co-chairs of the Cybersecurity Caucus. And just one clarification, I'm not the ranking member of the full Armed Services Committee. Adam Smith would be upset if I didn't set that record straight.
By mistake, sorry.
But I am the ranking member of the Emerging Threats and Capabilities Subcommittee that has jurisdiction or oversight over NSA and U.S. Cyber Command. So, and I also am on the Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Protection Subcommittee as a senior member on the Homeland Security Committee as well.
And so looking, having been involved with sort of cybersecurity issues on the Hill for as long as you have, and linking back again to the comments you made on the last panel, how much confidence can we have that Congress is learning about the issues and growing in its expertise?
Well, clearly it's come a long way since I first started getting involved in this field. And I wish it were. I could claim that I have great influence over my colleagues, or that all the great work that Mike McCall and I have done in terms of the number of briefings and all that, that was the reason why there's this greater awareness on the challenges in cyberspace. Unfortunately, it's because of the enormous amount of hacks or intrusions and the cyber vulnerabilities that have been exposed due to high profile attacks at Target or Sony. Saudi Aramco, the list goes on and on about the damage that has been done because of cyber intrusions, not to mention to our banking system and other challenges. But we obviously have a lot of work to do, but the awareness level has been raised both among my colleagues in Congress and now and across the country. Now, they're getting better, but cyber isn't still everybody's issue in Congress. And I think one of the most important things that we really need to focus on is bringing down, eliminating the jurisdictional boundaries and battles that go on different committees and subcommittees that have jurisdiction over this issue. Right now, there are some 80 committees or subcommittees that have jurisdiction over cybersecurity. And I mentioned that in the previous panel, and that's just far too many. If we really want to get significant legislation through Congress, it's going to take a streamlining of jurisdiction, and that's long overdue.
So just picking up on that hook about getting legislation through, last Congress, we had the passing of the CISA, the Cybersecurity Information Sharing Act, which was some time in coming, and you had a role in that, I know. What's the next big topic for Congress? One piece of evidence that people are beginning to get is interested in cybersecurity is the number of bills that have been tabled this year with some cybersecurity. I'm guessing many of those will not get through. But what do you think people are willing to get behind and despite all the difficulties, you know, get enough votes to take through?
Sure. Well, I think we're still going to focus on building the cyber workforce. That will be one. But I would also say that Congress is going to be more of an oversight role right now to look at the degree to which the information sharing legislation is having the desired effect, or if not, why not? We want to get to more of a point where we're allowing for greater machine-to-machine sharing of information. How are we doing in implementing that? I think the other thing that we need to look at, and something that I'm going to be focusing on a great deal over this next couple of years and beyond, is metrics. Focusing on really in determining what is working, what's not working, because it's one thing to have these policies and this framework in place, but if we don't know the degree to which they're being adopted or the degree to which they're being effective. Then we're doing ourselves a disservice. So I would say this is going to be a time for oversight. There will be other bills, I'm sure, that are going to be making their way through Congress. I have, for example, a vulnerability disclosure law that I'm proposing, and I'd like to see that move forward. But
tell us a little bit more about that.
So right now there's a patchwork of vulnerability disclosure requirements around the country. Some states are more aggressive at it than others. And yet I think the industry would prefer that we had a uniform standard. So my bill would be a 30-day vulnerability disclosure requirement that when a company is aware of the fact that they've been hacked, that company data or customer data has been stolen, and they could be their identity could be vulnerable, that there would be a requirement that as soon as they become aware of the cyber intrusion, the hack, that they would have to disclose that within 30 days.
And how confident are you of taking that through?
Well, it will be it's going to be a work in progress, and I feel good about it, but I also know the jurisdictional challenges and the inertia trying to get things through this legislative environment is not going to be easy. But I think it's something that makes sense. And the more industry, by the way, or the private sector can chime in and saying that that we need a law like that, the better off we will be. More likely that something will make its way through Congress when it's a kind of a public-private partnership.
The other piece of draft legislation that's sort of attracting some attention is a bill proposing providing the private sector a greater ability to hack back, engage in active defense, which chimes with a sort of sense that we've maybe seen, at least from the Trump campaign, if not more recently, of giving more responsibility to the private sector. Tom Bossert said last week at CSAS he's reaching out to people on the Hill. Can you just give us a sense of, A, what you're hearing from the administration, and B, whether you think giving the private sector a greater role is something that Congress would get behind or not?
Well, we haven't heard a whole lot from the administration on this yet, but I will say in Congress, right now, there doesn't seem to be the appetite for supporting any kind of hackback legislation, and I'm in the camp of not supporting hackback legislation. I think there's a general understanding that there are, and there could be, and I'm sure there would be unintended consequences that would result in that. I mean, I kind of equate that to cyber vigilantism, right? It may feel good at the time, but it's not a very responsible way to handle a cyber attack, and I think that's best left to law enforcement, to government to handle. At this point, we need to work more closely with the private sector, obviously, to close vulnerabilities and determine, you know, what the appropriate course of action would be if private sector is in fact hacked. But I think working through traditional channels is going to be safer, more effective in the long run without the unintended consequences that haven't been fully vetted.
Nate Fick, the CEO of Endgame, who started our conference, described hacking back as responding to a snake bite by biting the snake.
Yeah, that's a good analogy.
Sticking for a moment with sort of government organizational issues, in your capacity as ranking member of the Emerging Threats Subcommittee, one of the things that you'll be thinking about is how DoD is organizing itself to take on a sort of cyber mission. And there's been a lot of debate about the relationship between NSA and Cyber Command. Can you just give us a sense of where you stand on that and also where you think the mood music is going?
Sure. Well, as you know, the U.S. Cybercrime was just elevated to a Joint Combatant Command, and so that's a work in progress happening right now. And I'm very pleased at the progress that's being made in developing the cyber mission forces within U.S. Cyber Command, whether it's the National Mission Force or the individual cyber mission forces within each of the services. And they just recently, cyber mission forces were certified as unit capable, and so we're making progress there in training and U.S. Cyber Command realizing its full mission and value to the Pentagon. But clearly, modern warfare has forever changed. Right, we're never going to see modern warfare again ever break out either in small scale or large scale conflict without some type of a cyber component to it. So I'm pleased that they're moving in that direction. And getting more proficient at using our cyber capabilities. There will be this ongoing debate in the near future as to whether or not NSA and Cyber Command should split. That will be an ongoing and an emerging discussion or decision that will have to be made. Right now, I don't believe that they're ready to split. I don't think they should. I think they're, in many ways, one is dependent on the other. And so I think to be effective going forward, that relationship will always be there. Whether it's going to they'll actually split at some point down the road, it's very possible. But I think it's a ways off.
Just staying with the sort of theme of security, but taking more widely and looking at the international piece. One of the things that you have been vocal on is the sort of wider issue of deterrence in cyberspace. And my colleague Peter Singer testified in front of you in the last few weeks and made the point that we need to build a better deterrence strategy. How do you think we can do that better, and what role do you think Congress can have in that?
Well, I really do believe that we need some more clarification in terms of international agreements, establishing international norms about what's acceptable and not acceptable in cyberspace. And too much of it is the Wild West out there right now in cyber, and the more we can have countries come to the table and develop these rules of the road, I think the better off we'll be. I think there was certainly value in having the U.S.-China agreement that President Obama and President Xi had worked out, and we've seen benefits as a result of that. But without those types of broader agreements, we're still going to be challenged internationally and dealing with cyber-related issues. So I know that that's something that is a work in progress. There was the talk about a cyber Geneva Convention, if you will, and I think that that is a laudable goal, and we should work toward that.
And you know, talking to your Republican colleagues, how confident are you that some of the progress that we've had in terms of international agreements will be maintained against the background of the professed sort of America first foreign policy from the administration? Do you think that the commitment to being strong on cybersecurity will balance the desire to sort of move away from multilateral arrangements?
Yeah, so I certainly hope not. We'll wait to see the effect that President Trump's America First policy will have. It's one thing to be talking about that on the jobs front. It's another when you talk about security arrangements. I think we all benefit from both public-private partnerships. We all benefit from international cooperation on this. But I will say one of the lessons learned is that I think that both governments and the private sector should be working more closely together. And again, we're policymakers, are not digital natives in dealing with cyber-related issues. Staying close to the researcher community is important, and this kind of maybe segues a little bit into the Wassenaar arrangement.
You read my mind. That was going to be my next question.
If you want to ask the question, we can.
Well, merely to say, and you referenced this a little bit on your last panel, for those people who are not aware, most people in this room might be, Wassenaar is a non-proliferation agreement where it's traditionally been used through the Cold War to prevent proliferation of capabilities. And 2 years ago, came to be applied to cyber capabilities. And as a result, there have been sort of unintended consequences for the international cybersecurity community. The Obama administration tried to make changes and failed. The Trump administration have said they're going to take this forward, and the congressman has been sort of vocal in supporting and encouraging them to do that. My question is, firstly, how confident are you that we will get changes? And looking at it more widely, what does this tell us? What lessons can we learn for how we might develop sort of policy in the future?
Well, this is a prime example of how, because the fact that negotiators at Wassenaar were not as comfortable with IT or didn't realize, think through the ramifications, we wound up using a kind of a Cold War legacy agreement as the guidepost. It was kind of a convenient vehicle to govern IT in intrusion software and preventing it from falling into the wrong hands. They tried to apply an agreement that, say, governed dual-use technology not getting into the wrong hands, for example, protecting satellite technology, for example. And you find out that you couldn't apply the issue of IT and satellites are very different. And so after the Department of Commerce was charged with writing the rules for implementing that, that's when the IT community came forward and said, "Well, wait a minute, you can't do this because you're going to actually inhibit cybersecurity research and cybersecurity threat information sharing because Wassenaar would have actually technically prevented from that kind of collaboration from actually happening." So staying closer to the cyber research community and partnering more will be essential going forward.
Cool. We have 10 minutes to take some questions. So if you could put your hand up and we'll bring a mic to you. First question over here, and then we'll come this way.
Thank you, Congressman. Can you talk a bit more about...
If you could just begin by saying who you are and where you're from.
I'm Tom Risen. I'm freelancing with Aerospace America. Can you talk a little bit more how you said Congress should be more specific in its cybersecurity oversight? I'm wondering, because in the 1970s, Congress decided that intelligence oversight wasn't specific enough. It was spread across too many different committees, like foreign affairs, and et cetera. And so they had dedicated intelligence committees. Are we in a similar situation where cybersecurity is spread across too many committees?
Yeah, so I think we're at some point may have to move in that direction, and it may be time in the near future to have a committee that is charged more specifically with dealing with cyber-related issues, or in whether you vest that in an existing committee or you create something new. I don't think that the current jurisdictional arrangement is conducive to seeing a complicated piece of legislation dealing with cyber moving quickly through the Congress. And you know, I understand the concept of only the best ideas floating to the top. That's the way the founding fathers designed our government. But in an environment where technology changes and moves so fast, I think we're gonna need a better mechanism for both oversight as well as policy solutions that need to be moved through Congress more quickly than what we see currently.
And what would have to happen to make that shift?
It would require a rule change. You know, creating the House Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence and the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence, it didn't happen overnight, but it really happened after the Watergate era, as I recall, and so the what came out of the Church Commission, if you will, was one of those one of the solutions was in dealing with the challenges of jurisdictional battles and boundaries, and you know who's has preeminence and the particular topic. They solved that by creating the select committees. So it would take certainly the Speaker making a decision on the House side, the majority leader on the Senate side, or you have a meeting of the minds where it becomes self-evident that we need to have this type of a jurisdictional détente, if you will, and you have a committee that either exists currently that has preeminence in dealing with this legislation, or you have to create a new body.
Another question. In the center here, please.
Hey, Dan Arnato from the University of Washington. I just wanted to follow up on the discussion of export controls and how you think VASANAR can be reinforced so that the regime is stronger. I know we've had the case, for instance, of the export of technology to Syria that was diverted from Iraq under false pretenses. And I'm just wondering if you can explain a little bit more about how you think we can strengthen this regime, either through VASANAR, perhaps through other instruments such as the Budapest Convention on Cybercrime, or you know potentially even a new instrument altogether.
So I think that eventually you're going to have a new agreement outside of VASANAR. I think that was. They tried to make that work there, and I think still we will see the appropriate change within VASANAR on this intrusion software, and export controls will get through this one. But going forward, I don't think we can use necessary existing legacy agreements as the vehicle, and we're going to need something that is more current and relevant too. To the challenges that we're facing right now, so I do believe. And by the way, I will tell you on VASANAR, from what I understand, there was pretty broad agreement after some very intense negotiating. That we see the problem. It took some time to get everyone there, But the United States and our negotiators did a good job, again, working with industry as giving technical support, if you will, to making the point that we need to make changes. And I think most countries are there. We had actually, ironically, there was maybe one or two holdouts that wanted to go a little bit even further. And I think that that's, I think in the next round at Wassenaar, I think we'll see progress.
Other questions? Over on this side, please.
Hi, I'm Libby Hennemuth from the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy. Thank you for this great conversation. My question has to do with what you were talking about earlier regarding metrics and understanding better what cybersecurity is working and what's not. Could you delve into more where you would start in that process? Are there any models that you would look to first?
So right now, we don't really have an entity that is charged with determining the metrics and whether they're working or not. So, for example, NSF maybe could be a place that we go to and have the National Science Foundation or NIST itself be the entity to determine metrics, but they don't have the resources or necessarily the expertise. More the resources, I should say, to be able to determine metrics and then weigh them and come out with a final determinant as to whether the things that we put in place are in fact working. So we're going to have to figure out what the best way forward would be, but it's something that really has to be addressed and something that I'm going to be working on in this Congress.
And what do you think that process could look like? I'm guessing hearings and then potentially funding a right. study or something?
Yes. So I would like to see, and I'm in the process of looking at of drafting legislation that, again, would require have a metrics requirement to it, and then report language as to where we would house it and the cost that would be involved. So I expect within a short amount of time we'll actually have legislation that will do just that and put some more meat on the bones, if you will. But I think that's going to be important going forward. And we also have the Congressional Research Service that we will work with in drafting something like this. And there's a number of paths that we can take and actually we would house it, but it's something that really has to be addressed.
Time for one more question.
Sorry, it's on the same topic, metrics. There is a bill from the House Science Committee. Are you looking at that in terms of working on whatever legislation you might be drafting?
Sure. I mean, collaborating with colleagues is going to be important, and I'm sure there's other people that have ideas beyond just myself. So, it's still early in the new Congress, but there's going to be, I'm sure, other individuals that we'll be looking at a system for metrics. But we have some great resources in the IT and also in the tech community that will help us to put together the right framework for what metrics we would look at. But we put all this time and effort to putting together the NIST framework, and that was a great example of a public-private partnership. We had industry at the table developing that framework, but now we need to look forward, moving forward, to see whether or not it was the NIST framework was effective or not, and the degree to which we have buy-in, who's using it. The same thing goes for the information sharing legislation that we put forward, that passed through in the last Congress. It's one thing to have brought down the barriers to information sharing, and that was a real problem. We had very nervous corporate attorneys. I think that was probably the legislation was mostly aimed at dealing with corporate attorneys because they were one of the biggest barriers to information sharing, even though the Justice Department, for example, said that they're not going to prosecute any corporations that share information for cybersecurity threat purposes. But the corporate attorney said, yeah, until we see it in writing, it's not going to happen. So we passed the information sharing legislation, but now we've got to see if actually companies are taking advantage of the opportunity to share the information, and then how we can improve it going forward and get more buy-in, by the way, and getting more people participating.
So we're running up against time, so final question from me. When we sit back here next year and look back on sort of first year of this Congress, first year of the administration, what's the one thing that you would like to have seen achieved in this space? We've had the NIST framework, we've had CISA. What's this year's success story that you're looking and hoping to take forward?
I would hope that we will do a better job of a path forward for protecting the .gov network, if you will. I think you have NSA and U.S. Cyber Command that are doing a better job at protecting the .mil network. We need to have I think more focus on protecting the .gov network, and then working again in partnership to close the vulnerabilities in the .com world, if you will. But right now, from government standpoint, we need somebody that's in charge that has both policy and budgetary authority. That's something else that I'll be working on going forward to close vulnerabilities in .gov related cyber vulnerabilities. But there are great opportunities there. We haven't yet seen the direction the administration is going to be taking on cyber. We're still waiting for a cyber executive order from the president. I am pleased to hear that that he is going to be appointing a cyber coordinator, and there was rumor that position was going to be done away with, but a special assistant to the president for cyber, so that position will stay. The other thing that I want to see is whether or not we're going to have a federal CISO. That was something that President Obama had a position that he created and appointed at the end of toward the end of his administration. I'm hoping that position stays, but getting better organized within in government is something that I'm going to try to push forward, and that I will gauge as a metric for myself as to whether or not we're moving the cyber ball forward.
We look forward to having you back in 12 months' time and working down that checklist to see where we've got to. But for the time being, thank you very much for joining us, and thank you very much for all you've done on this issue. Thank you.
Thank you.